Howdy, folks. This is Ted Lasso, your favorite optimistic American football coach turned English football coach. And welcome to the Richmond Way, a Ted Lasso Rewatch podcast. So grab your biscuits, put on your AFC Richmond scarf, and let's embark on this journey together.
Hello again, everyone, and welcome back to another episode of the Richmond Way. With me, as per most of the time, is Michael Soren over here, somewhere on the screen. And then joining us for the first time are the Glatfelters. They're, one of them is beneath me, but not in that way. and then the other one is on the other side of the screen. So welcome, Colleen and Jay. Welcome to
Hello.
Hi!
Excited to be here. Big fan of y'all. Big fan of Ted Lasso. And big fan of this episode. This was...
It was
fun to rewatch this one and kind of get back into that 2020 headspace. Maybe it's not fun to get back in that 2020 headspace.
Yeah, no, everybody wants to get back there.
This season was like so therapeutic on so many levels, and this episode especially like had so many revelatory things to it. So yeah, excited to be here.
Yeah.
Yes.
And Bonnie also sends her regards. She had a last minute thing that came up. Otherwise, she would have been here with us, but she sends her regards to us.
Just so Bonnie knows, I'm going to assume it's because she hates us and didn't want to do this show with us.
Well, that sounds fair. That's fair.
Yeah, I didn't not say that.
I mean, we assume message she sabotaged received, my car the last episode. So.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. Yeah, I don't know when that will be released in conjunction with this, but we did just recently talk with Julie Higgins, aka
Mary Roscoe.
Yeah, Mary Roscoe. It's been a
Mrs.
week.
Higgins.
Yeah. And it's only what, Monday? Yeah, cool. Yeah. Awesome.
Lemon, it's Monday.
Yeah. Oh, but yeah, that Mike's brakes got cut. He almost died and fell into the river, and you know, it was a whole thing. But not really.
But the fun ending to that story, my car broke down and the mechanic took fault and fixed it for free.
Wow.
Oh, I thought you were going to say you ended up on a houseboat with an attractive man.
I mean, that also there are other outcomes to that story.
Yeah. So did hand people.
Yes.
Sorry.
So, because there are four of us in this, I will go with Mike's favorite name of this is instead of a round robin, we will do a square sparrow. With this, we will start with our guests. We'll go with Colleen first, then Jay, and then Mike, and then I will.
What?
That's not a square if you go that way.
Wait, it's why am I going first? I'm so scared.
Your overall impression of this episode that we watched.
Okay, I love this episode. Honestly, I think that it is. There was a very special quality to season one of Ted Lasso. You know, overall, and it was the fact that everybody is an adult. There's the drama stuff is worked out in a grown-up way. People apologize to each other. People forgive each other. You know, there's no like third act, like, you know, everybody gets mad at each other. And then we have multiple episodes where we've got to come back together, which I think the issues with season three and the Roy Keeley stuff, why people had a problem with it, but like things were always solved in such like a mature way. And I think it set a great example for people like how to act like an adult. And I love that this episode is called All Apologies and everybody's going around and making a tones for the things. Can I curse? Can I say effed up?
We're 10 minutes in. You're good.
Okay. Well, the things that they messed up on. I really like how this was just another example of what really makes Ted Lasso elevated the first season and the show in general. Set such high expectations for the series is this was just another example of a way a series took a mature way of handling conflict. Plus it has Roy the Grouch, Roy on ice, in ice, which is great.
Before he ever got to meet Oscar the Grouch in real life.
Yeah.
Yes.
No, echoing a lot of what Colleen just said, I think it didn't take the stereotypical you know, drama school of writing approach to these interpersonal conflicts. And the show does it a lot of times, like when it goes, I think it's the season two, it's still in this season where, you know, Roy Kent's upset because, you know, Keeley slept with Jamie Tartt. And right. It was like, well, maybe you should let your feelings control you. Like,
the sign. And,
yeah. And it's so refreshing. Right. It's so refreshing. And especially in that 2020 context, as a lot of us were probably working through things because that's all we had time. All we could do was have time to like work through our collective trauma.
While gaining more trauma at the same time.
Yeah, exactly. Going through this collective trauma while trying to work through old trauma. But there, it had so many things that just felt really moving. And maybe that's not how people normally would handle those kind of things. Maybe the more natural response to Rebecca finally coming clean would have been, F you, I hate you, I'm going out of here. But the refreshing thing about the Ted Lasso way, or the Richmond way, as this podcast is called, is kind of letting or accepting human beings as flawed individuals and realizing that, you know, you can't write a perfect script, and to kind of allow the inspiration in and the forgiveness in. And I don't know, it's a really powerful thing. And I think this episode like perfectly encapsulated that in a lot of different ways, from Rebecca and Ted Lasso, Rebecca and Keeley, Rebecca and Higgins. And then you had Coach Beard, him having real conflict with Ted Lasso, or Ted for the first time, and the benching of Roy, and Roy coming to terms with probably his career's over. Like, there's just a lot of just let's have adult conversations to figure out our different conflicts. It was really moving.
You could see how much attention and care the writers took to handling all that.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, and this episode is written by Phoebe Walsh, who plays Jane. Coach, the Jane to Coach Beard, the Coach Beard to Jane. Yeah, but that's, who wrote this episode, too.
Checkmate.
Yeah. She was just playing the whole time.
Mate.
No, I mean, it's what you guys said, and so I'd be like, we were watching as a show to mindlessly drift off to. My wife and I were watching New Girl, and watching that and then watching this, it's like, I know what happens in this, I know what happens in New Girl, but it's like, it's not your standard comedy for TV. Whereas Rebecca apologizes and Ted forgives her, and I'm thinking of that show, someone apologized, there would have been a screaming match, door slamming, someone stomping around all mad, and then a crazy scheme to win them back.
Like, yeah, probably all Nick.
Winston, a famous CC Winston mess around. But no, it's different than what we're used to, but it's refreshing because of the differences.
Exactly.
Yes. Because it feels more appropriate for life than a crazy scheme and these elaborate heists that people go through in the other sitcoms of the world.
Yes. It's just like, I wish more shows were like that.
Ratchet up the zaniness.
But that's where it's like it's this thing.
It still had zany moments, like Roy in a trash can, and the vibrator lines, and
But people, I feel like people criticize this show sometimes that doesn't. It's not really a comedy or whatever. It just kind of has a bunch of references and things.
It's
natural
comedy in a way. Exactly. It's not like slapstick in your face, even though it has those moments.
It does. It really does.
People don't want to think, though. That's the real problem.
Yeah.
To make someone think, they tune out.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. I think I would echo what all of you said as well, too. And then just how it will do, like, this very good, tightrope walk of going between tone and, like, doing it really well, too. Because you can have, like, this very comedic scene like in one part of this episode where Rebecca's like trying to procrastinate, is almost very Ted-like in that scene. She has like the semantic I'm doing it myself. The semantic satiation. I don't know. What Ted had a few episodes ago, like when they were doing in Two Aces with like when they were saying aces.
Oh yeah, they get stuck and they're just like, yeah. Oh, I can't.
But yeah, she's like procrast and like trying to do like the origin of all that.
Yeah, that was like that brought references of like the manure lines from Seinfeld, like how manure is a beautiful word to me.
Yeah.
And then her being so nervous turned her into Ted.
Point. No faffing around, because that's just annoying, and definitely no procrastinating. That's a good word, isn't it? Procrastinating. Procrastinating. Oh, I wonder what the etymology of that word is. Obviously, pro, very good, but crast? I have no idea. Hey, why don't we look it up? Have you got a dictionary?
Not on me. Are you doing okay?
Me?
Yeah.
I'm brilliant. Okay. Yeah, I am. Top of the pops. Ted, do you think you could do this later?
I was like, that's just like the face-off moment where she's Rebecca, Hannah has to act like Jason for a moment. And I thought that was some good little bit of comedy having her do the Ted style of rambling.
But also like her processing through that, like in the conversations with like Key, like, have you told him yet?
Fug, right up your nose.
You're being a right floppy cock, Rebecca. Why haven't you told Ted yet?
Oh, I'm going to.
When?
Imagine doing something unforgivable to someone who doesn't deserve it and then having to look them in the eye and tell them what you've done.
I don't have to imagine. I've done it.
You know, what I love about that is Keely's holding her accountable.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And a lot of times, you know, people may not feel comfortable with that. Like that's a true friend, someone that'll hold you accountable to you being an a-hole, or a prick or whatever. Those kind of friends, like, hold on to them because it's so rare to have people that'll be honest.
You don't want to be surrounded by yes people.
Exactly. Right. And so, like, you know, Rebecca's character is so lucky in that she has it. That's the first relationship probably that she's had with someone that actually will hold her accountable and not just say yes because she's wealthy and intimidating or whatever. And it's that dynamic is so special to see because then even Rebecca lets her guard down. She's like, well, I just don't want to do it because how do you tell someone you were an absolute horrible asshole? And because it doesn't make any difference. And then, you know, Keely's like, well, it changes how I think about you.
Yeah.
And that's the thing that kind of clicks for her. Because she cares about Keely, clearly, and that accountability that Keely's putting there is what, you know, forces her. Well, that's part one, and then just seeing how horrible Rupert is, like absolutely terrible human being Rupert is, and then just her coming to terms with, I can't be like this. I can't keep playing Rupert's game because this is, and Rupert gets his comeuppance in season three, but her that realization, that revelation, those two moments, those two things was really powerful for her journey in this episode.
She wants to be a nice billionaire. She wants to be a Mackenzie Scott, not a Jeff Bezos.
There you go. So really quick, I'm gonna do what Ted does in this episode and
hit the rewind button.
So with this episode, the synopsis for it was after a series of mistakes on the pitch, pressure mounts to bench Roy. Rebecca finally reveals the truth to Ted. And like what we've been talking about too, like with how like Hannah Waddingham plays it in this episode too. So, and how much of a highlight is on Roy in this episode. This was the episode that both Brett Goldstein and Hannah Waddingham submitted for their respective supporting actor categories.
Yeah, I was going to mention how excellent I thought Hannah was in this episode.
And they both won. So,
There you go. As they should have.
Yeah, I mean, this was definitely a good episode for both of them to use for that. And I really, you can see it too, like we were, because you see the range, especially for Hannah Waddingham in this, where like being super silly, but then also you know.
Yeah, just going from that scene to the Rupert scene, it was, mm-hmm. I mean, granted, there was probably time in between the takes, but still.
Yeah.
But it's just, and not even just, you know, her vocal delivery, whatever, but just her facial acting mm-hmm. in the Rupert scene. And the way the music, the pacing of it all, it's like devastating. Just her.
I suppose I didn't want one with before. I mean, in the end, it's just about being with the right person, isn't it? Of course. Oh, I'm so glad I got to tell you this in person. I would have hated for you to read it in the press. Good luck against Man City.
Facial reaction.
Yeah.
And then Rupert going like, well, maybe I just didn't want it with, you know, basically saying with you.
Yeah.
But then he like, right. Like just his, like he did everything on purpose, and just her facial reaction to it is devastating to watch. Absolutely devastating to watch. Agreed. And yeah, no wonder she won that, because it was incredible.
Yes.
Now, while we're talking about that scene, right before it, I'm just going to bring it up. She's doing that little tidy up your mess, like mantra almost to herself.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it felt like there's, with the writing, to me, I was like, there's something more rooted in the backstory with that chanting to yourself that just added a layer that I just was like, this is awesome. Like,
yeah.
such good writing in that moment.
Maybe almost something that we'll find a little bit like later in season two, or like the thing where like to make yourself feel better,
yes.
Like bigger. Like,
was that two?
I believe it's season two. Yeah, because it's like when she's trying to show Nate that in season two. It's
yeah,
like, I thought it was
No, it's she does it in three, but she explains it to Nate in season two when he's trying to book the reservation at the Greek restaurant.
Yeah.
Oh, it's Taste of Athens.
Yeah, Taste of Athens. Thank you.
So like we talked about the open scene a little bit too, like with Roy in the ice bath in the trash.
Yes.
A lot of symbolism there.
That's true. We get the first instance, I think this is the first instance of Ted saying big whoop. And then like big whoop becomes like a thing that like other characters will say throughout the rest of the show too. So it's kind of
I don't think I've ever noticed that.
Yeah,
it's been interesting with the rewatch, like noticing stuff that I know will come back later on.
Right.
This time. And so it's like noticing stuff like that, and then like even Roy in the ice bath in the trash can there, he's having the conversation with Ted, and they're talking about Danny, or like Danny's just still out on the field like practicing. He's like,
there you are.
Everyone gone?
Yes, sir. Well, except Rojas. Darn kids out on the practice pitch still doing drills.
What a fucking awesome.
What a fucking asshole.
Like,
and then when Danny comes in there, he's singing in Spanish, and I mean, you already saw my notes, but did you know what he was singing in Spanish?
No. When we
in that part.
The theme song.
Yeah. They kind of hint at it, because of like where it ends, where he's like, see, like as it goes into
I could barely hear him, I guess.
Sorry.
Or I wasn't paying attention enough. I just thought it was background noise. So I wouldn't.
Can I just say something about like Jason Sudeikis's voice when he says big whoop? There's just certain words and the phrases that he has, but his like big whoop, like I can't do it, but it's just this tone to it that just is comforting, like a buttered biscuit or something. Like it's just, it has this comforting reassurance when he does the big whoop. And there's so many times in life where things can feel overwhelming, or things can feel like this is the worst possible thing that could happen in this moment. And in reality, like it's not that big a deal. There's far, you know, greater things in the grand scheme of things than this one thing. And there's his delivery of the big whoop or whatever. It's just, it not only is the phrase there, but his delivery and the timbre of his voice to it, like, is pitch perfect.
Yeah. It's almost very, like, Sam Elliott-esque.
Yeah, very much. It has that...
It's the mustache.
It is the mustache, yeah.
Maybe the way it's like the airflow of like the way like voice carries under or over the mustache with the dampening.
Big whoop. I can't. It's just there is something to it. I'm telling you, it's there.
All right. Mike, you had some notes about like the scene too, like with the.
I did.
Like, yeah, you did.
No, I just thought that was just a lot of symbolism with Roy in the garbage can for them. Just displaying where he is in his life at that moment. Like the first image you see is him emerging from an ice bath in a trash can mm-hmm. while listening to news story about how he sucks yeah. in the
dark. On the rocks, which I think is the name of the score that Marcus Mumford does there too. It's called Roy on the Rocks. So he has a little bit of Giacchino like pun titling for some yes. stuff in the scenes in here.
Yes.
But, and then I was confused because I was like, why is a $1 billion sports club using trash cans for ice
baths? Probably just Roy.
I think he made it for himself. Yeah, exactly.
I feel like Roy just does his own thing.
And how is he going to get out of that without spilling it? Because I don't think he's tall enough to get out of it.
He's here, he's there, he's
everywhere. He's every fucking where.
Just like the water when he gets out of it.
Yeah, exactly. but can we just talk about like that? That wasn't real ice water, right? He would die. I don't know how people do.
No, some people can do it.
Fully submerge yourself in it.
Yeah, that's like a whole thing. Like ice baths are a thing. There's people that do it for minutes at a time, like lots of minutes at a time.
We'll have to age Brett Goldstein and ask him.
You should. Actually. We should.
Yeah. I would.
It helps with the inflammation. That's probably why he was in the ace bath. Yeah.
But fully submerging yourself in ice water. And it's acting. So you have to imagine they have how many takes? Maybe a whole half day of shooting or something? You can't. That's not real. There's no way it was real.
Titanic did it, and that was real.
Leonardo DiCaprio
was really dead.
Yeah, Leonardo DiCaprio was actually a clone.
Exactly.
Yes, he was replaced by the same doppelganger agency that replaced Avril Lavigne, apparently.
Yeah, that's right.
And apparently they keep replacing his clone every 25 years, and that's why
every 25 years, he can't live beyond that.
Yeah, so that explains the whole creepy 19-year-old girlfriend thing.
Oh, no, 25-year-old. Once it's 25,
the current one's 19, and then she's
no, she is not.
Oh, no? Okay.
She turns 20. She's 25. She turns 26 in June.
Oh, okay. Cool.
So her days are numbered.
Yeah.
The days are numbered.
Expiration date.
Check the milk carton.
Yeah.
Oh, like the other thing I thought was cool, there's kind of a little bit of stuff going on, like in threes in this episode too. I noticed with a few different things, but so there's the scene with Rebecca and Ted where she's like doing like the profile for a woman in football. She's like, it's just me and like four other people, and like one of them's like Posh Spice because Victoria Beckham. But there's like, I don't remember what the exact line is here, but like Ted says me about like little girls are mysterious.
Yes, I love that line.
But then Keely will say it again later on.
Teenage girls are different. Like, it's
funny. Yeah, it's like similar. Yeah, teenage girls are really
mysterious. Yeah.
And then I think Rebecca says something similar later on too. But I just thought that was like an interesting. There's usually like in comedy, there's like
the rule of three,
rule of threes. But I didn't know if maybe there was like any other kind of subtle thing that they're trying to do there. And there are other, I mean, other than Phoebe's also in this episode too. Phoebe's always awesome to see it in these episodes. She's so tiny in season one too.
Yeah.
I know.
Yeah.
Well, she's legitimately six.
She's so wise.
Always so wise. I love that British. Season three of like, Roy, this is stupid. You're an idiot. It's like, no, you don't understand. She's filming another TV show and we won't be able to be together.
They also references her mom for the first time in this too, which will eventually.
They do.
Rebecca does.
No, Roy references Phoebe's mom, his sister.
Okay. Sorry, you said Phoebe, and this whole time I'm thinking you're referring to Phoebe the writer, not Phoebe.
Oh yeah. Although maybe that's why Phoebe is called Phoebe.
Oh,
most likely.
Because there's also somebody on the staff whose name was Keeley, too, and like these don't.
Well, wasn't he dating a real life Keeley, like an influencer whose real life was name's Keeley? Yeah.
Yeah.
Who plays Bex, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
And he was also getting divorced.
Yeah. Well, yeah. That's a whole other podcast. And crying over salad dressing, apparently.
Yeah. Listen, I'm gonna assume that salad dressing was banging. Okay.
Yeah. Agreed. Clearly.
Good old. I've cried over salad dressing.
Stinking.
Yeah, Jay got real mad once when the Green Goddess ran out.
Awful. You know, you get your salad, you get the lettuce, you get everything in there, and you're ready to like pour that sweet.
I was like, we have dressing. Italian, and he's like, "Where's the Green Goddess?" And I was like, at the store still.
I think there's still some left. Go and pour nothing.
This may or may not have actually happened. You know what?
This is the New York way.
Yeah, this is the New York way. We are going to London in the wintertime, so we will probably try to go to Richmond, actually.
Nice. Should go. For real. There's the embroidery. I don't remember the name off the top of my head, but there's an embroidery place that's immediately across the alleyway from Ted's apartment.
Okay.
And they're like the only place that like sells like Ted Lasso stuff there. Cool. But they from time to time they have the snow globe, like the Richmond Green snow globe. Mm-hmm. That like Healy.
Oh, Jay, we gotta get one of those.
Yeah, and if you want one, that's gonna be the cheapest way to do it. Because if you try to order one off the website, because you're ordering it and then shipping it to the U.S.
Shipping
is then the same amount as the snow globe. So
we gotta do it. Yeah, we gotta do that.
Yeah.
As long as I pack it, not you, because last time we went to Europe.
Yeah. I know. Everything got broken. It was terrible.
Or you just carry it on the airplane the entire time.
No, that's what we did. No, that's what we did, and it was not great.
Then maybe not.
It's a whole other story. Poor countries. Shut up.
So,
I meant Jay, shut up, not you, shut up.
Oh, no worries.
You can tell him shut up. It's okay.
Speaking of little girls being mysterious, or I guess teenage girls being mysterious.
Whoa, where's this going?
I don't know. Keeley, like when she tells Rebecca like the story there, and she's like Rebecca's like, imagine doing something unforgivable to someone who doesn't deserve it, and then having to look them in the eye and tell them what you've done. Mm-hmm. She's like, I don't have to imagine, I've done it. Yuri, I took a shit in Joanna Wellington's locker. I apologize. I invited to her birthday party. And then we patched it up a week later just to fucking tell him. And then Rebecca's like, sorry, why did you do a shit in her locker? I don't know. I was 13. Teenage girls are like mysterious and dark and dangerous.
That's right.
But,
oh, boy.
Yeah. Keeley's a lot to... I like what we learn or keep learning a little bit more like about Keeley like throughout the season, too. So adding more and more to Mike's reason why she's either a character that needs to exist or a character that doesn't need to exist. But
I'm still not convinced she needs to exist. She can be there, but not a focal point. Because in season 3, they just like, we don't know what to do with her.
And you know something? That's why... it's better to know what to do with her and have her be a focal point in the beginning. I'm just saying. I don't know. No. I love Keeley. I think she had moments in season 3 that were really great, but I think they just were lost because they couldn't all shoot together, which was a disservice to season 3. But
yeah, when I was watching season 3, I was just like, wow, they really didn't need her. Like, why?
I don't know. They didn't want to like leave her out, but it definitely, because I recently just rewatched the entire series.
When did you do that? You did it.
So I load them on my iPad and flying to Italy, then to London, then back home. I watched the entire series. And there is a significant pacing problem in season three. And it is that kind of like, well, we're trying to fit all this stuff in. Mm. And you're right, Michael, like just dropping, like just saying she went to go do something else for whatever would have been easier than trying to like shoehorn this storyline in
right.
there. But at the same time, if they're thinking this is the last season, like we can't do Keeley dirty. Like she needs to be here, but it does kind of hurt the pacing, I think, in season three.
Just do the salute like right.
I was just gonna say,
like, speaking of that, like, kind of like what they did with Jamie in this season, like, where like they built Jamie up and then like he's kind of been missing for like an episode or two now.
Yeah.
Where they maybe could have done something like that.
Exactly.
In the last season with her, where maybe she's not like in all of the episodes, but mm-hmm. like spread out where you're like, oh, I want to see Keeley again, but she's not here mm-hmm. in this episode or that episode too. And then like,
yeah. They could have just given us more episodes in shorter fashion if they wanted to tell these stories.
Mm. That's true. Yeah.
I don't know how Apple was like.
Is it more expensive to do more episodes, even if right, they're shorter? Because you're yeah, or yeah.
Yeah, because then you're paying production for more.
Just film it all at once. Like, Lord of the Rings
productions at this. Well, it's still segmented into like pay periods and stuff like that, and you're probably then paying the actors more because it's technically a different production for each like. Production order, like yeah. each of those things too.
That's yeah. There's logistics behind it that we can guess at, but and yeah. reasons why.
Well, because like this anyway. Season two is also the only season of the three that is 10 episodes, and then you know season two and three, like well, season two got those the 11th to 12th episodes ordered like pretty much after they had written the season, so that's why you know Beard After Hours and Carol of the Bells kind of feel yeah. like. Their own separate kind of side episodes, but are
yeah.
still
yes, not they were in. yeah.
But then
I skipped that one on the rewatch. By the way, I skipped the beard excursion. Uh-oh. So
I actually like the beard you. Excursion.
Just I'll see myself out. This was a lot of fun, everybody.
Although, you know why? Because there's a lot of things from the beard. There's a lot of things. I'm used to that. There's a lot of things from the beard episode that really they come back into play. Oh, look, now I am beneath Marc. And you are relegated to the corner, sir.
Wow, so you're saying being underneath Michael is being relegated?
Yes.
What Richmond is?
This is the Premier League and then over here.
Hey, this is the championship, okay? That still sounds pretty good to me.
Yeah.
No rants.
Okay. Jay, you got us off topic, but the beard episode has a lot of callbacks too. Just saying. Okay. Yeah.
Well, you know what? I didn't miss it at all. No, I'm kidding.
Well,
you know what?
I'll cue to one of the call forwards that I had in here was that we had this little interaction between like Boz, Jeremy, and I don't remember the third soccer hooligan's name. I know they all have like flower names because like May Green and then like mm-hmm. all of that. So it's supposed to be like she, like they're her like garden.
Yes.
Yeah.
But like they have like the whole interaction with Beard there in the pub in this too. So you can see there's like a friendship that's kind of formed with them at this point. And I took note of that with this one because I was like, oh, okay, so you can kind of see that building a little bit here with Beard's friendship with them. So it's just not like an out of the blue thing when we get to Beard After Hours in season two.
Yeah.
It's just like randomly hanging out with them. Like you can see it's already started to build up kind of like a rapport and stuff. Where there's a whole like side season of just Beard After Hours episodes of stuff that Beard is doing when he's not with anybody else.
Yeah.
In the but
being
like
paid to bite people or yeah, being paid to bite people.
Yeah.
That was a great little
yeah, that
mystery
was,
of Beard.
That was interesting. And like one of the things too that I don't has anyone else watched the My Adventures with Superman animated series?
We started it, but we kind of fell off. But we did. The family has loved it. The ones we've watched.
Okay, so
not all about that, but yeah, we did start it.
I posted like a while ago on the Richmond Way Instagram. I don't remember if I posted anywhere else, but so there's an animated character near the tail end of the first season of that. That's a reporter in the Daily Planet. Yeah, Daily Planet that looks straight up like James Lance as Trent Crim. He doesn't talk or anything, but I was like, is that amazing. Is that supposed to be Trent Crim? And you know, they're both Warner Brothers produced things. So then when Ted calls on him in like this scene here too, and he's like, Trent Crim, and what is it? He's from the Daily Planet, right? So I was like, oh wait, what? So I was like, I'm wondering. Maybe it's like four-dimensional chess where it's like that, yeah. Like that Easter egg is like much further on. I don't know if it's supposed to be in reference to this or they're just like, we like Ted Lasso and we're just going to throw Trent Crim randomly into the Daily Planet here in this episode of My Adventure with Superman. But when that happened, it just made me think back to My Adventure with Superman, which is a good show. Side note for people to check out.
Yeah, it's a great show. So good.
I think season two starts soon too. So
oh, good. So yeah. We'll catch up. I've been in this X-Men 97 zone. So freaking good, X-Men 97. Not to derail, yes. But yeah.
But there are no rails.
Definitely agree with that.
We didn't install.
Well, yeah. See, I can even do a 6 degrees of separation that for you. So oh, Theo geez. James does the voice of Bastion in X-Men 97. Theo James in the White Lotus season two. In the White Lotus season two, Theo James and his wife. And Aubrey Plaza, I don't remember all the actors in that, but they have a conversation about what show do they watch?
Ted Lasso. Wow, Marc. See, that's superpower. That's a superpower, my friend. Yeah.
And
that's why you're the Premier League, and we're over here in the championship.
Now, if only I could use it in some form or fashion to get paid. So, I'll just try out for that pop culture Jeopardy.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, exactly.
I will do that.
You can manifest it, my friend.
I will. But just not manifest it in the way that where I disappear in an airplane for 5 years.
I mean, I think as long as you're not whistleblowing Boeing, I think you're going to be fine.
Oh, my God, yes.
Sure. I'll just find Josh Dallas and he'll help me out.
Not a bad person to, yeah. That's your houseboat guest. You're Josh. that's your yeah okay sorry
yeah Fandral before it's Zachary Levi Fandral.
Okay, so you're the Richmond Way young hey yeah. Listen, all this is to say that young girls are mysterious.
Young yes. girls are
and Patrick knows that better than anybody probably.
Right? Yeah.
I have a 5-year-old daughter who is mysterious.
Oh, I was gonna say, yeah, you probably also know that pretty
well. You're the only person with a daughter here.
Yeah.
Yep. Is she mysterious?
Yes.
There you go. All right, everybody, that's been the Richmond Way for all.
That's it. There's nowhere else to go.
We solved it.
Well, and then the only person here that's been a little girl is Colleen. So were you mysterious?
I was loud. I made myself heard.
Was?
M. Yes.
That's long. Mysterious. Is that a Long Island thing or a girl thing?
Both.
Definitely a Long Island thing.
Well, there's so many people that you have to shout over everybody.
Yeah, it's...
Well, especially when you're Italian and your whole family is loud. You gotta learn. You gotta project.
Like this.
It's
you gotta swing your arms violently.
Yes, in the hands. But the thing is like...
What are you talking about?
Well, it's the
I mean,
thing
I can only imagine how off the rails we'd be if Bonnie was here then too, because Mike, Colleen, Bonnie.
I literally broke a glass at dinner the other night because I was talking too violently with my hands.
Oh wow!
That's
slapped
incredible.
It across the restaurant.
That Our Colleen
has
is,
done that before.
Colleen is dangerous with her hands. Like if I'm sitting next
so
to her
Henry,
while she's
though.
Telling
he's
a story,
broken things.
Her fingers get like all like right up to my eyeball when she's going all like this, and I have to.
Wow.
I want to make sure you really understand what I'm talking
about. Like, she'll put her like pinky out too. I'm just like, are you trying to poke my eye? Just
no, it just goes
it's
out.
It's involuntary. It just happens.
It's from playing violin for all those
the
years.
The Ace Ventura scene.
Oh, yeah. Oh, man.
There you go, Mike. Cut to Ace Ventura pushing his eye right
now. I can just push
what,
my
this,
eye.
This?
No.
This marker is...
Context.
Contact people. We can do it. Exactly. Yes, contact people.
No, that's why I don't wear contacts, because I can't touch mine. Or you could put a scene from Fire in the Sky with the needle. That's why I have needle phobia, is because of that movie with like the needle going the dude's eye.
I'll just go even further back in what the hell's his name? That French artist with the loopy mustache. Oh, I forget his name.
Back off.
The '50s. No. Oh. He made a movie where he put someone's eye between his fingers and slices it open.
All right. Well, I'm out.
Dali. There you go.
Oh, okay.
Salvador Dali.
Salvador.
That's a, yeah.
Or Dali. Salvador Dali.
Yeah. I had to watch that in film school several times.
Oh, cool.
So, okay. Talk about people that have cut people to the core.
I can derail a conversation myself.
Well, I was going to make a Milo and Otis joke about how we had to watch the dog give birth a bunch of times, but I decided against it. That was my
Milo
pause.
Milo and Otis.
Probably a good choice. So speaking of babies and giving birth, Rupert comes in. Yes. Yeah. Rupert comes in and is a huge piece of shit to Rebecca. Which I like how she's like, when he tells her that he's going to be having a baby with Bex, she's like, you're the Bible. You're 70 years old. They're going to inherit dust and an
Amex black card.
I was like, hey, just like Robert De Niro and Al Pacino, who are also like
Mick Jagger
years old. Having babies. I was like, man, I feel sorry for the kids. Like,
you know, at least they get to exist, you know?
Yeah.
I would hope they got some money and they'll figure it out.
They'll be like, oh, my dad was in these movies when he was alive. Ooh, before I was cognizant of him being a person.
Exactly.
Okay.
You know,
thing is literally the creepiest thing I've ever heard in a movie. I have never failed to cringe. Like, I'm not. The ooh-ah. I hate that so much. It makes me cringe and want to like vomit.
No, hold on.
Like,
I mean, the movie is called Scent of a Woman.
Scent of a Woman. That's an incredible movie.
Even my vagina tenses up. I hate it so much. Like, my whole
I
body
don't
recoils.
We watched it and you love that movie.
No, I didn't. I didn't finish it. You and Caitlin, my sister, finished it. I never did.
Oh, no.
That's wild. It's a great movie.
No, it's not. It's.
I cried. Chris, come on. There's Robin in it.
Do that too when I do the Instagrams for the broadcast. I will screen cap it at the timestamp where that's the episode number. Nobody's ever noticed.
Nice.
Do you do the same thing?
I do. I put it at 11:11, so that.
Oh no way!
Yes, people can make.
I love that.
Yeah, like it gets posted at 8:15, and then I go back in and retroactively edit it because 8:15 is like a better time for it to actually go out.
Yeah.
11:11.
It's also some lost numbers for 8:15.
Yeah. Oh yeah, so you got like double the luck.
Yeah.
That's when I put all the stuff out as 8:15 because of that. Yeah.
No way, really.
Yeah.
Well, that's awesome.
Are those really lucky numbers though?
I don't know.
They're not. They're cursed.
Well, yeah.
Just ask. Just because, you know, living is easy with eyes closed.
The numbers are bad, Marc.
I don't know.
But if you add them all up, they equal 108.
Can we talk about just, do we
the
need to jump
found?
Into
the annual
the actual
found.
Reveal?
It's in there. We can timestamp it out.
I love Ted's quote on divorce because I just feel like it's really.
Mature.
I think Marc, you put it down in your notes, but
yeah. So did. I'll do another thing where we've done it before, Mike. Where when you have it segue.
Is your audio will cut out. What?
Rebecca's truth bomb to Ted. All right, Rebecca, I have something I need to tell you. Deja vu, Rebecca. I'm a fucking bitch. Nope, that's new.
I have something I need to tell you.
Deja vu.
I'm a fucking bitch.
Nope, that's new.
Ted, I'm so sorry.
I forgive you. Divorce is hard. And it doesn't matter if you're the one leaving or if you're the one who got left. It makes folks do crazy things. Hell, I'm coaching soccer, for heaven's sake. But this job you gave me has changed my life. It gave me the distance I needed to see what was really going on. Yeah, but you and me, we're okay.
Great line.
I lied to you. I hired you because I wanted this team to lose. And then just throw my dice. But yeah, like what you were saying.
Where I do it.
Like if it's already played, like Ted says the thing where he says divorce is hard. It doesn't matter if you're the one leaving or if you're the one who got left. It makes folks do crazy things.
Yeah. So such a poignant thing, so powerful, and even if you're not getting divorced but I think if you've just ever had a relationship, even if it's not like a you know, love relationship, if just any relationship with anybody, yeah. Relationships are complicated, and when you're going through tough times, it can make you do crazy shit, and just like that self-awareness thing, and him having the self-awareness, mm-hmm. especially while going through a divorce. As
that was
a kid,
even before he started therapy.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, right. Like as a kid that lived through a nasty divorce, what I would have given for my parents to like have this level of fucking self-awareness, and so it's really impactful. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I would assume that it's always obviously better when it would be like an amicable like thing, rather than you know. Although there's probably instances where, you know, like if it's going to be a slow build, death by a thousand cuts, that cases could be worse too, because sure. It's like a slow motion thing. Would you rather be a slow motion thing, or would you rather be like a super fast head-on collision that's like immediately over and done with?
Always the over and done with quickly, but the problem is like usually if it's a big thing like that, repercussions for years probably.
It's a slow, but right. Yeah, the slow motion thing, like at least if you get to that realization, you can like mentally prepare yourself. The cat is now literally all the way across the room with my box. That's what she said.
Yeah, I was like, I'm not gonna touch that.
That's what she said.
Somebody else has got soundboard mic. There you go.
Jay.
Yeah, I got a mall. What do you need? I got it.
No, no, no. We're back to the episode.
Yeah, just here you go.
No, but I think you know what's worse? Every bit of packing thing that was in there, Jay, is all now on the floor getting ripped apart. So that's
awesome. Let me stay on focus, Colin. We're trying to do a podcast.
I'm thinking about how I have to clean this up in a minute. that was my bad. No, I think that the slow-mo is probably a little bit better, like psychologically, because you can prepare yourself and you can start to, you know, be like, okay, this is ending. And yeah, you might be like feeling sick and gross and whatever during it, but like you can at least kind of, you know, have a leg up. Okay, that was my psychological talk tonight.
I don't know. Do you want to drink now or do you want to drink later? Like that's.
Yeah. I mean, yes. they've been.
Yeah, are you trying to tell me something, that. Colleen?
Have you seen the cat across the room? She's ripping shit up left and right. No, she really is. Can you hear her?
No, I can't.
No, we cannot.
I mean, Sylvie was just doing that with the carpet beneath me too.
Oh my god!
That sounded like a euphemism too. So,
carpet was actually carpet.
I was actually talking about the carpet on the floor.
I was talking about the carpet.
It does not match these.
No. Yeah, carpet, boxes, everything's getting wrecked tonight.
I was talking about the carpet on Higgins' face with his Van Dyke.
Oh my god, I love the Van
Chill
Dyke.
Higgins.
Chill, cool jazz, smooth.
Here's a good segue
jazz.
For you too. Is like, speaking of dicks, Rupert. Higgins had all right, never mind. Proceed.
No, I just I love him sitting there with his you know upright double bass and jamming and
slapping.
Yeah, slapping the bass, man. That's what you put here in the notes.
Totes my goats.
Totes my goats. It's wild how many quotes from that movie, and I don't think people like realize that those quotes come from that
I can
movie.
Do a 6 degrees for that too. Jason Segel in I Love You Man with Paul Rudd. Jason Segel in Shrinking, which was written and developed by Brett Goldstein. Brett Goldstein is Roy.
Only three? That's three separate 3 degrees, yeah. Right? So
yeah.
But I love that. I love the Rebecca line of, you know what the little fucker did? He forgave me, you know. Yeah.
Like, what an asshole.
Yeah, what an asshole.
Which that's another kind of callback to the thing with Ted and Roy talking about Danny earlier in episode two, where like they're talking about someone like doing something like nice or just like uncontested, and they just call the person like an asshole for doing
yeah, that. Exactly.
So that's like the first time like within the season that I've noticed like them doing a bunch of those within one episode.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, and you guys kind of pointed out too, but with the episode be called All Apologies, because you have Rebecca apologizing to Higgins, apologizing to Ted.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of Ted kind of sidestepping, but in a way apologizing to Roy for telling him.
Yeah, that saying I have your back, but I actually got to kind of like.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And
go ahead.
I love that whole sequence of, you know, Ted Lasso goes to the bar. Beard has the 5 beers because he expected Ted to kind of have this tough conversation, but he didn't. And then Beard breaks. He's like, no, these aren't kids at college playing football. These are professionals. This matters. Winning matters.
Hey, fellas.
Well.
A lot of pints just for us.
I thought you might have had a tough time with Roy.
Coach, you are a natural born caregiver, like Chief from Cuckoo's Nest.
He's always more of a Tabor guy.
But if I'm being honest, I actually never got around to telling Roy. Now, don't give me those eyes. He figured it out all on his own. I can see you're happy now, but don't be, because I've been thinking about it, and I'm starting Roy against Man City, and that's that. Look, putting him on the bench wouldn't just be humiliating to him. It could actually affect his livelihood. And you know better than anyone that all this ain't about winning to me. Because that ain't how we measure success, right?
Damn it, it is!
Hey, who put a firecracker up your butt and lit it?
You did! I'm sick of it. Look, I understood this mission. We were in Kansas, but those were kids and these are professionals. And winning does matter to them. And it matters to me. And that's okay. Ain't that right, May?
Hey, fucking minute is.
To them.
Right.
Like, we could get relegated. That matters to this city. I think it finally hit Ted that Beard's right. Beard's 100% right.
Yeah.
That turns on, what's his girlfriend's name?
We're
on and get off.
Jane.
Jane.
Thank you, Jane, playing chess. And then there's just that really cool, again, this is what the shorter length episodes do, is it you have to get to things pretty quickly. Like, you don't have a lot of time to waste. So like him walking from the bar and then almost getting hit by the car because he's looking the wrong way, which, by the way, when you're in London and there's a crosswalk,
it's a very real thing.
Yeah, it's written on the road saying, hey, look the other way, jackass. but anyway,
how many Americans died that they had to paint that on the ground?
Right? Exactly. How many? But
it was because they died or because they had to clean them up?
Both.
Probably cleaning them up. Both. But yeah. but then Roy stops him, and then there's just that really cool scene in their apartment. You have great jokes like the Alfonso Ribeiro jokes. And his neighbor to the on upstairs yelling.
Like, oh, yeah.
The reference to the peanut butter jar, just to scoop out a finger of peanut butter.
I'm good.
You got nut allergy?
I've got a finger allergy.
What else have I got to offer you here? You got red wine? Mm-hmm. You got tea? Yeah, ooh. 2-day-old pasta water.
He's fine. Yeah. Look, I'm sorry I told you to go fuck yourself.
Man, la-di-da.
I'm usually better at hiding my anger.
You think so, huh?
But then also,
no allergy? Finger allergy.
Yes.
Good line.
Oh, good.
Yes.
But in an episode where, or other TV shows, the Rebecca Ted thing would have been the whole episode. But in a 30-minute episode, you had this whole storyline of Roy Kent like coming to terms with his career pretty much ending.
Yeah, I always remembered the Rebecca apology, like the end, like she says it and then the episode ends. Like that was how it worked in my brain.
Yeah.
And then I watch it again. I was like, wait, that happened way sooner.
Yeah.
So I was surprised by that because, again, it defies the convention we know. There wasn't a cliffhanger of this apology in the aftermath.
Yep.
And you might have been remembering it that way because of like how it called back to in season two and season three, sure. where it is like at the end of those episodes.
Most likely.
And it's, but. Yeah, like one really quick with the Higgins thing too. I like where when he's talking about the Van Dyke, he's like, it makes me chill. And then she asks,
Chill Higgins.
Chill Higgins.
How his wife likes the beard. Yeah. She hates it with a white burning intensity.
So, Marc, how does your wife think about your beard? You've had it for a long time, I think, as long as I've known you. Or just about. Yeah.
She's liked it. I don't know.
He's had it since they've been together for the most part.
Yeah. Well, it's evolved. Like when I see pictures of when Patrick was born, I'm like, why didn't anybody tell me I had a really stupid beard? Because I had that stupid chin strap beard, and that was it.
And frosted tips.
Oh.
Frosted what?
Tips.
Oh. I was like, frosted? I was like, what? What? What am I?
Frosted
what
am
I? Mind out of the gutter.
Frosted nips?
Yeah, I was like, all right.
That's not a trend yet, is it?
It's starting right now.
Yeah, I think that she's liked it. But yeah, because there's only been a few times where I haven't had a beard, like where I've shaved it off for like Movember or just randomly. Because I live in Arizona and it's hot.
Colleen hated mine with a white fiery passion.
No,
but are you fine with it now, or have you just kind of learned to live with it?
I just gave up.
Okay, but if you had your way, would you prefer I go clean shaven?
She'd prefer a Van Dyke.
Or a Van Dyke.
A Van Dyke all the way.
Okay, good to know.
All the way.
Also, Higgins grows facial hair quickly.
Yes, it was like a week or whatever.
Unless, yeah, it was like, yeah, what has it been, like a week and he grew that? Like,
yeah.
In a week.
That's one problem with this show is you never know how much time actually elapsed between episodes.
Yeah.
Sometimes
they've just won their past seven games. Like it's been 30 minutes. Jesus.
Yeah. Oh, Mike, you had a note in here too, like about that scene where it's like you're the bass, like
string, the music. Thump.
Yeah.
Like,
but
they're talking
noticed...
and you just hear one bass note.
Well, I noticed like, it's Higgins
sitting next to him.
He's
I didn't
he's
notice just, him do that. Okay.
I noticed that this time he was just sitting there, like, bung.
Yeah,
like he's doing
like
it.
Nervous, kind of like.
Yeah. But yeah, like the I think we moved over. Oh, there's the scene before this. There's the like the prep. Sorry, training.
Practice training.
Yeah, he's like, they're on their field, and he's like, if you don't warm up properly, you're like, rice. And
oh, the...
yeah, and Sam has
the rice line.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Him and like Danny talk about Montezuma's revenge, mm-hmm. and then this is like another one of the three joke things in here where it's talking about like the like how bodies are a miracle.
Yeah, the human body, it's a miracle. I love that line.
Yes.
It's just so interesting like that this episode specifically has a bunch of like those rule of three like mm-hmm. And it's not really that way in most of the other episodes in this season, so it's just interesting that it's this episode particular that they chose to like do a bunch of those like layered kind of jokes like that.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it's a more comedic episode, I'd say, and less dramatic. Even though there's a high level of drama to start, they kind of swap and go comedic very fast.
Yeah.
And mm-hmm. layer that in.
Yeah, and you have the Dale Rice, and then he's talks about the 2-day old pasta water, Yes. In the sink. Yes. So you can still, but so it's like a very subtle cue of like how Ted really actually isn't.
Yes.
Okay. Yep. And like even the fact right. that like he's like slightly drunk and like he you guys said with like him almost walking out mm-hmm. into the road because of that, kind of a little bit of a callback to like what Henry
first
like when he's like when Roy asks him if he can think about you know sidelining himself and he's like I'd call you a dumb poo poo face if you
exactly.
Yeah.
Or they had like the reference about little girls being mysterious again one more time.
Gotta think about it.
I'd call you a big dummy poo poo face if you didn't. Well, be honest with me. It's a prank, right? A tea. Like when us tourist folks aren't around. Y'all know this tastes like garbage.
I love it.
You don't love it, it's pigeon sweat. Horrible.
Yeah. But and then it's also like this episode's the first time like they do their credits like over footage.
Yeah, I love that.
Yes. Yeah.
And then Roy slowly just walking up and smacking the belief sign, like kind of
yes.
symbolizing that he's like now fully like
yeah,
embraced it. The lasso way.
Hey man, the Rebecca are full in.
Well, and it what I like about that extended credit scene, it allows it, there was just so much to process in that episode, so it kind of allowed you to kind of sit and marinate in everything that happened in that episode. Like it was a really apropos and clever way of doing that.
Yeah. The diamond.
Someone telling you you're done.
No, the diamond dog just wanted to. Hi. But yeah, like, and then like as far as like other stuff in the episode, like some of the character highlights I had in there was just like Rebecca finally owning up to her choices and being accountable to them. Roy having the existential crisis about who he is if he isn't a footballer. And then. I already kind of went over some of we talked about that, but yesterday our butts had teeth marks, deep ones, the kind you usually pay. And Nate's like, you paid yes. someone to bite you? Beard.
No, paid me.
Of course yeah, not.
Been paid.
Love that line.
And then there's the other Coach Beard one at the end where Roy says, my six-year-old niece found my girlfriend's vibrator, so I had to take her.
Been there.
Your first. And then, of course, another Ted, be honest with me, it's a prank, right? The tea, like, when us tourist folk aren't around, it tastes like garbage. Pure sweat.
I love tea. Are we all tea fans? Raise our hand, tea fans.
Sweet tea. Like
that's not tea, but okay.
Exactly. That's all. If it's pure sugar water, I'll
do it. Oh, Marc Vibbert doesn't like it. Colleen, you like tea, yeah?
I'm mid on tea. Like,
Am I the only tea fan?
I am okay with peppermint tea, but other than that, I don't really like tea. I mean, I drink it because I am convinced it has health benefits, but like otherwise,
I love drinking tea. It. But I'm mostly British by genetics, so.
That's not true. He's mostly Italian by genetics.
No, I'm not. I'm 50% British, 54% British, according to 23andMe. I'm only like 19% Italian.
Anyway, I have this tea with melatonin in it, so I like that.
Anyway.
You know, it's great. Okay. It's great to fall asleep, but then you wake up at like 3 a.m. and you have to pee. So it's also not great for
falling asleep. I thought you were saying you'd have melatonin nightmares.
The melatonin nightmares are the worst. No, they are, though. They are. I've
never had one, so I've heard of
them. Oh, no, they're crazy. Anyway, okay, sorry. What were you going to say?
That's it.
Watch who's back.
Oh, can I just say you had a note about the songs? I love this kind of love during the Rebecca scene. Like it's just a perfect little
as she's walking to it.
Like it's really heavy. Like it sets everything up perfectly.
Yeah, and yeah, I like that one. But that's I've been making this for our podcast. People can like follow if they want to as we've been through. Mm-hmm. So that it's basically, it's like the featured music, like so it's just because I like the music in the show, and you can tell that it's like, it's always very chosen very specifically for the mood, or like for the scene, or what it's referencing within the episode, or whatever it might be, where it's like super on David Bowie's Diamond Dogs for the Diamond Dogs, or if it's like the Marcus Mumford song London, or London Forever, for Tan Lines, where like he wrote that for that episode. So it's,
well, it's what's his name, the showrunner from Scrubs, right?
Bill Lawrence.
His shows have always done a really good job of choosing the right song to kind of to score a scene. And the same is true here, I think.
Yeah. And did you guys have any favorite quotes or anything else that stood out that you wanted to bring up?
The human body is a miracle. That's I think I used that quote.
We do it all the time. We talk about the human body being crazy all the time at home.
Yeah.
Nice. How about you, Mike? Did you
swear it out, Roy?
Swear it out. Yeah, it's a good one.
But do you have any?
We covered all the rest of them.
What? I'm sorry.
Oh, I was just asked if you had any more too.
I couldn't hear. Sorry.
Sorry, because Roy's talking.
Are you?
That's our. We're doing that. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I was like, Roy's... it sounds like it's coming from this way, and I'm like, oh my god, is Jay pranking me right now? Like, where?
Yeah,
is
Roy. From? Roy's just telling us it's the end of the episode.
The end of the episode, Colleen. Wrap it up.
But where, so since that's gonna wrap us up for the episode, thank you, Jay and Colleen, for joining us. Where can
Having us, even though we were a shit show. Thank you.
Oh, it was great times. Don't worry about it.
It was a fun one. There'll probably be we'll give Mike more work, so there'll be an extended episode and a shorter version.
Join their Patreon to get their extended episode. I don't know if you have a Patreon or not, but you should.
Yeah, we do.
Good.
Oh, do it.
Yeah.
Patreon.com/TheRichmondWay.
Boom.
But where can people find you guys?
Colleen.
Jay, all you. You can find Jay at geekdadlife.com.
What?
You can find Jay at youtube.com/geekdadlife.
Yeah, Geek Dad Life for most things. Up Twitter is Geek Dad Tweets. And then relaunched a podcast.
Yes, he did.
Under the Geek Dad Life banner called Toy Geeks, where each week we deep dive into a year in a different toy line. And so for our first mini series,
it's Batman about... with Chris O'Donnell as Robin.
No, it is not. It is Masters of the Universe.
He-Man.
You got Adam West Batman there. So we've done one episode. The second episode is dropping tomorrow. I don't know when this episode is airing, but maybe there'll be a second episode or a third episode.
No, the next episode will drop on Tuesday, May 21st. And then May 21st. Episode will drop on whatever 7 days from
Tuesday,
that is.
Yeah. But Tuesday mornings, Toy generally. Geeks. It's co-hosted by Dan Larson from Secret Galaxy, a well-known YouTube channel. And then for this week's episode, our special guest is Jay from Sledge Central, also one of my favorite podcasts, the Purple Stuff podcast. So I'm excited for that episode dropping this week.
I thought you were talking about yourself in third person.
It's another Jay. And then our next guest is going to be Pixel Dan, so another Dan to go with our Dan on our show. So great.
Pixel Dan.
Yeah.
So basically, if your name is Jay or Dan, you got an in.
You got an in.
There you go.
But at Toy Geeks, search it, Toy Geeks on any of the podcatchers. That's where we are.
You should go live stream from the Museum of Play in Rochester, New York.
I've heard great things. Many people have recommended.
It is
or the section of the Rochester airport.
Yeah. We can go to a Wegmans where we're almost going to get killed.
Yes.
You can go to the Mecca of Wegmans in Pittsford, New York, where it is the massive, makes Canandaigua look tanks. Small.
Ooh, I'm intrigued.
Nice. And then even though she couldn't join us tonight, you can check out more of Bonnie's work at bosuperhero.com and find all of like the stuff she's done there too. And then for Richmond Way, you can find us at richmondwaypod.com and all the past episodes, Patreon stuff's there. The featured music playlist is there. All the things are there. And by the time this episode is, we've already done our fan fusion panel here in Arizona, so that'll probably also be there by that point as well too. So thank you again, Colleen. Thank you again, Jay, for joining us.
It's happy to be here. Always fun.
Thank you for having us. Thank you so much.
So until next time, folks, be curious, not judgmental, and keep rewatching. This is Ted Lasso signing off. As the man once said, the harder you work, the luckier you get.